Mike Leck, and welcome to Adventures in Scale Modeling. For nearly 100 years, this truss bridge provided a major transportation link across the New River Gorge, replacing this structure and turning a 30-minute or more drive into just 30 seconds is the world's longest single arch steel bridge, named for the gorge it traverses some 876 feet below. This engineering marvel is the design work of the Michael Baker Engineering Group. And later on in today's show, we're going to meet with C.V. Knutson, the leader of the 15-member team who designed this awesome structure. Bridges have opened our world and our country to greater development and mobility. Therefore, it is important that we have a representation of a bridge in our transportation exhibit, similar to this great structure, in that it has many parts and requires careful attention to alignment, is the model railroad truss bridge we're going to build today. So let's go to the museum and begin that construction. Our museum's transportation exhibit is making great progress, and we've developed our modeling skills and techniques in the process. The bridge we build today poses a new challenge, but master model builder Jim Kelly is downstairs in the workshop, ready to share his expertise with us. Let's go and join him and begin building the bridge. Our model bridge is one of those projects we're going to have to pay close attention to alignment. Jim, what kind of progress are you making on the model bridge?
Oh, it's going along real well, Mike, and we're through with these little girder pieces, and we're just about ready to start putting them together and make something that looks more like a bridge.
Now, I see when I came down the steps, you're paying close attention to the instructions. Haven't you gone through them yet?
Well, I was reviewing it again before I start making these truss sides because there are pieces here that look alike but are not alike, and I want to make sure that I...
Well, the instructions are pretty clear here. I can see that they show you a photograph of the bridge. Does that help you in the construction?
Oh, that's the most helpful part of the instructions, isn't it?
That's great. Right. Listen, Jim, I also see that you have sitting down there what is that, a piece of paper with some drawings on it?
Right. This is the template. This is the construction template, and we'll actually lay the pieces out on here and cut them and fit them and start building the bridge.
Let me come around and get a closer look at that. Is that something that comes with the instruction sheet?
Right, that comes with the instructions, and there's a lot of information on here that is not in the instructions that you also need.
Okay, well, how do we do this? You have half of it taped down. What about the other half?
Well, we'll just go ahead and tape the other half down.
And what does this do for us?
This just holds the template still so that while we're cutting and fitting, it isn't slipping and sliding around.
Oh, I see. Well, I'm anxious to start doing some kind of construction. What's our first step?
Okay, the first thing we're going to do is take off a little wax paper.
What's this for? We're not doing any cooking here.
No, but this will protect the template.
Okay.
Because we'll be gluing on here.
So we have to tape this down also.
Right. Now, wood and plastic don't stick together, and paper is basically made out of wood. But paper nowadays has a lot of chemicals in it and can have some kind of a plastic coating on it. And these things can be dissolved by the same solvents that we use on the plastic.
I see. That's a very important tip. Here's something else. It's around the household wax paper. I'm sure we have it there. We do cooking in our homes. We use it on our template. We protect the template, and it helps our parts not stick to the paper.
Right.
Very helpful tip, Jim. Now what do we do?
Well, now let's do some cutting.
Okay.
Here's a piece that goes here. This is the end piece of the bridge.
All right.
And I've cut this end. You can see that I've cut that.
Yeah, it is a little squared off there on the end there.
And now I'm ready to make the other cut.
Okay,
there's a nice guideline right there to help me.
What are you using?
This is called a razor saw, and it's very aptly named because it's thin and sharp like a razor, but it has little teeth on it like a saw.
Oh, okay.
And it's very good for cutting.
Now, is there any
plastics.
Trick to how you cut this?
I would say the main trick is to draw slowly back on the saw a few times to make a nice starting cut.
All right.
Then once you've got started, then you can go on through.
Now I see you moving around there. Does it matter if we're now on the template or on the table?
No, now that we've got our starting line cut, we can move off of the template because I have to use the template to make four of these sub-assemblies.
Okay.
So I don't want to cut into the template and mess it up any more than I can help.
So it's really cutting through there real nice for you.
Yeah. The key here is to go gently and slow so that you don't tear these pieces apart that we've glued together.
Yeah, I see a cut into the table, so you would have definitely cut into the template.
Yeah, we would have damaged the paper a little bit.
Okay, what are you doing now?
Well, you can see that's a little rough, and we'll just smooth that up with this orange stick. It's amounts to sandpaper glued to a
wood stick. Emery board, a very inexpensive item.
Right, and a very useful item to have in your workshop.
Okay, now that that's set, what do we do next?
Okay, let's lay it down, and looks like we did a...
Yeah, you're following the template exactly.
Good
this
job.
This helps in our alignment?
Right.
Okay.
Now, I've already cut the piece that goes up here.
Okay.
That fits together nicely. We might be able, adjust that just a little bit.
Okay, so we're doing some final sanding here so that it aligns a little better.
Because you saw we had a little bit of a crack there at the top.
Okay.
Maybe it'll fit together. That's a little better.
Okay.
All right.
Now what are we going to do?
Now.
How do you keep those pieces still? Oh.
Well, we have something even better than that. We have some
You're going to tape it down. You were grabbed for the tape there.
Well, sometimes I do use tape, but this time I think I'll use these little pins, push pins.
Little push pins.
And we'll just push those in, and these will hold the pieces in alignment.
Oh, very clever.
Right.
These are very inexpensive also. Push pins are what, maybe what, 99 cents for a whole box of them? You probably get maybe about 100, 150 in a box for maybe 99 cents. In fact, you probably find a lot of them laying around the house.
Right.
All right, you got that tacked down there.
Okay. Now, we'll cement that together.
Okay, let's see what you're going to do with the cement now.
Okay, plastic cement, liquid cement. And you can use a brush any size. One good tip is, when you're gluing small things together, use a small brush. When you're gluing bigger things together, use a bigger brush.
Oh, okay.
This is sort of medium-sized thing, so we're using sort of a medium-sized brush. All we have to do is just touch it, and that cement will flow in there, join those two pieces together.
Okay. It is flowing in there.
Right.
That's great.
Now, ideally, we'd want to leave that alone for quite a while and just allow it to set up.
Half hour, 20 minutes?
Right. Let it set before we go on.
Okay, so what are we going to do now?
Okay, well, while this is setting, let's let you cut it, have some practice with this razor saw.
Oh, that sounds great. What do I do first?
Well, we need a piece that goes down here, and you can, this template shows the top view of that piece.
Okay.
And you can work off of there.
All right, so I just line it up to the template.
Right.
On this end here.
Right.
Okay.
Line these little lattice pieces up, with the drawings of them.
And I just give it a cut?
Well, make that nice slow draw backwards to get it started.
Okay. Okay, I did. Can I do that twice?
Twice, three times, till you feel comfortable with it.
Okay.
Now you can move it over to the side and start cutting.
All right. Let me move it over here and give it one. Now I just draw back and put a little bit more pressure on it?
Well, you should be doing your cutting forward.
I got it.
There you go.
All right. I went right into the table that time, Jim.
That's a good thing you weren't on the template.
Okay. Now what do we do? Can we just glue these two parts together?
Well, we're not quite ready. You'll notice here that it says that some of this lattice work has to be removed from the end there.
All right. What do we do there?
Well, a good tool for doing that is the hobby knife.
All right. What are you going to do to it?
We'll just cut two of those off the way the directions say. Always move the knife away from you because if it slips, then the knife will go through the air instead of cutting your fingers.
That's very important to remember because a modeling knife is very sharp.
Extremely sharp, as sharp or even sharper than a razor blade.
Okay, looking good, looking great.
All right.
Okay. Can I do the other side?
Sure.
Great, I want to give this a try because I don't get much practice with the hobby knife. So I'm just going to take this and do a little bit like this. That takes it off really easily. This is very easy to do.
Mm-hmm.
And as long as it's going away from me, you say I'm doing a pretty safe job?
I would say so.
Okay, now are we ready to glue it again?
Right, now we'll do some more gluing. Let's lay that down like that.
Okay. And got it in there?
Got it.
All right, let me do the gluing. I love to glue.
Great. This time. And here's your brush.
Right size brush?
Right size brush.
Okay, you hold those two pieces together and I'll lay some glue in there.
Okay.
Okay. One little
See
bit.
How that flows right in there? Capillary action just draws it right in.
Okay. There it goes again.
And you don't need too much. If you put on a lot, it just takes that much longer for the piece to dry.
Okay. That looks great, Jim.
That's good.
Now, how long does this, you say it should take to dry here?
Well, ideally, we should wait 24 hours, really, before we try to move on.
Well, what's this finally going to look like when we're finally done here?
Well, it just so happens I have a finished one over here.
Well, let's see what it looks like.
Here you are, one complete side truss.
Oh, I see. That really is perfectly straight, too. You know, if I sight down this baby, I can see just how perfectly straight it is. And this is all from putting it down with either tape or the push pins and leaving it down on the template.
Right.
Well, Jim, I see you still have a few things to do on the construction of the other truss. Why don't you go ahead and continue building the bridge? And we're going to take a visit to the world's longest steel arch bridge.
You know, the more I look at this bridge, the more I've come to realize the attention, the great attention they had to give to the design and function of this great bridge. C.V. Knutson, the the man who designed this bridge, and he's the retired director of structural services for the Michael Baker Group who designed the bridge, is with us today. And we're very fortunate because he's going to tell us how this bridge actually relates to the model we're building in our museum. Mr. Knutson, welcome to the show.
Thank
you. Glad to have you here.
Thank you.
Mr. Knutson, I am no judge, but let me say that this bridge is probably one of the most beautiful engineering structures I've ever seen.
Well, I agree with you.
Well, I'm glad you do. As we walk along taking a look at the bridge and talk to Mr. Knutson, I want to ask you, Mr. Knutson, this is, of course, the final design of the bridge, but how many designs were there? Was there any, you know, anybody pushing for a particular design, and how many designs were there? What kind were there?
We had numerous designs under consideration. The first was the a suspension-type bridge because of the span. As we got further into our study, we looked into a deck truss, a jackknife truss, and eventually we all decided that the arch was the most fitting structure.
And of course, you're happy with this design.
Oh, very much so.
Oh, that's great. Whenever you were building the bridge, did you have any idea that you were going to get into the record books as the world's largest single steel arch bridge?
After we had decided on the span, then we realized that it was going to be longer than any arch before, and there are only two that compare with it, and that's the Bayonne Bridge in New Jersey and the Sydney Harbour Bridge in Australia.
Well, that is some accomplishment. Mr. Knutson, whenever you were building the bridge, did you have any scale models of the bridge itself?
No, we never built a scale model as such. The fabricator, American Bridge, did a full-scale model as such because they built it in the shop full-scale and assembled it in the shop.
So they built the bridge, full-scale model, and then disassembled and brought it to the site?
That's right, piece by piece.
My goodness, how's that for a full-scale model? Mr. Knutson, the bridge itself, my question is, the importance of the model, if you had the time, the money, and the manpower, would you indeed have had a model of the bridge? And how important is that model to this bridge, and any bridge?
Looking back, I would have been real pleased if there had been a model of this particular bridge. When you get into a unique type structure like this, I think it would be smart probably to allocate money for a model. We probably could have saved the money that would have been spent for a model in the contract cost for the bridge, in that a contractor would know better what he's bidding on, and also during construction it would be a real help.